Good morning to all of you. Today we will start not a new topic, but in our last lecture on problem solving, I was telling you about a topic, and that is, what is the difference between rotating frame and the polar coordinates? So this lecture is all about that. Second thing is, what I found that when I write down and again I explain to you, it takes a lot of time. So from today onwards, what I have done, I have written down everything in the board and I will be explaining to you. So the video will be short, it will be easier for you to download, and at the same time I will give a good photograph of the whole board so that it can act as a note for you, a class note. And you can use it during the time of exam. Okay, so let us start. The topics that we are going to cover is comparison of plane polar coordinate with rotating frame. First, I will explain to you about the problem statement. Then, what is the difference? What is the difference between the two? Why is the difference? Then, is there any similarity and relations between them? I will take up the acceleration terms in both and explain you through an example. Good. Let me start with the problem statement. Now, in order to show the relationship between the rotating frame and the plane polar coordinate, I have chosen the same problem, the same example that we did in our last lecture or last problem solving class. I think it was example 1.16 of Kleppner, and there is a wheel. The wheel is rotating with angular velocity omega, and there are spokes, and in one of the spokes there is a bead, and that is moving out with a uniform speed u. And then it was asked to calculate velocity and acceleration. Now here, as you see, what I have done, we have the plane polar coordinates as well as this rotating frame. The rotating frame is in saffron color. The plane polar coordinates, both the origin is O, so origin is O, now in the plane polar coordinates, as you see, I have shown r cap and theta cap. The r cap and theta cap is rotating with the particle, because the particle is going out at the same time the wheel is rotating. But wherever the particle is, this r cap theta cap basically is changing its direction and it is rotating with the particle. It is with the particle. I have taken x prime, y prime. Now, this x prime, y prime is fixed to the wheel. So, it is rotating with the same omega. So, omega prime I have taken, omega prime is equal to omega. Now, this particular x prime, y prime coordinate, which is rotating with the wheel, so this is rotating with the particle. X prime, y prime frame is also rotating with the particle. Now the question comes that both this plane polar coordinate, that is your r cap theta cap, this is also rotating with the particle, this x prime y prime, this is also rotating with the particle. So are they same? Are they equivalent? In what way are they different, if they are different? So this is the problem about. So often this confusion arises, that what is the difference between the two, you know, coordinate system, because both are rotating. Now let us quickly see what we have solved in our last class. So this is the problem, this is the figure. The problem statement I have again written down in briefly. So I have to calculate velocity and acceleration. Velocity, I have calculated here, the same thing that we have done. This is the acceleration vector. Then we calculated the position vector r. That also we calculated. Now the position vector, we get x component. This is your x component. And this is your y component. Alright? So, the moment you take any time, say from 0 to infinity, whatever it is, a series of values of t, you get the corresponding value of x and y. So, this is your x and this is your y. Alright? And then, if you plot the position vector, this is your plane polar coordinate, position vector. So, these are all in plane polar coordinates. The position vector, when you plot it, you get the trajectory of the particle. Now, what we have to see is, this particular trajectory that we are plotting, this is with respect to xy frame or xy axis, which is fixed to the earth. Xy axis is fixed to the earth. So, in this particular trajectory, as it is shown here, at every point of its trajectory, we get not only the position, the velocity as well as acceleration. The velocity as well as acceleration. So, since it is an inertial frame, this becomes an inertial frame, we get real position, velocity and acceleration of the particle in plane polar coordinates. Okay? Now, in the rotating frame, as you see, that it is the position, velocity and acceleration that we get is with respect to x prime, y prime axis, which is rotating, which is not fixed. So, we are getting the position, velocity and acceleration with respect to the rotating frame. So, it is a non-inertial frame. And rotating frame is a non-inertial frame. Whereas plane polar coordinate is a inertial frame. So, this is the most important point that we need to remember. Out of this whole lecture, the plane polar coordinates is an inertial frame of reference. You get the real position of the particle, velocity and acceleration. The rotating frame is a non-inertial frame of reference. And the position, velocity and acceleration that you get is with respect to the rotating frame. Okay. That is the most important. Now, next question comes is, why is this difference? Why is this difference coming? Why it is becoming inertial frame and non-inertial frame here? Now, as you see here, that in the plane polar coordinate, we are measuring r and theta. Every time we measure r and theta, so the r is measured from the fixed point O. R is measured from the fixed point O. Theta is measured from fixed axis x, which is fixed to the earth. So, because inertial frame, so theta is measured from the fixed axis x, and that makes the whole of a difference. So that is what I have written here. If you see this diagram, here r we are measuring from the center, that is true. But theta, which I have written as theta prime, this we are measuring from x prime axis, which is rotating, which is not fixed to the earth. So that makes the main difference. Here it is with respect to fixed axis x theta. Here theta prime is with respect to a rotating frame. That is the main difference. Okay. Now let us see. Okay. So now we will see that what is the similarity between them. Any similarity, any difference. So let us again see plane polar coordinate and the rotating frame, the two figures. Okay. Now, what we find that the both these frames, basically whether it is plane polar or the rotating frame, they are fixed, the center is fixed, that is O. Both are O. Okay. And none of these frames, either this one is this one, they have any acceleration or velocity along the r direction. That means they are both fixed at O. So what happens that we don't see any difference in the measurement of r and its derivatives. Okay, so that is what you see. R is ut here, r is ut, r prime is ut here, the same, because you know r we are measuring from point O, and point O is fixed in both of them. Similarly, r dot u, r prime dot is u, r double dot is 0, r double dot prime is 0, because you know this is moving with uniform speed. So there is no difference in r or its derivatives. Now comes the theta. So basically this is all same. In the theta part we see the difference. Now you see, theta here is omega t, theta here is omega t. So here I must write theta. This is your theta and this is your theta prime, alright. So theta, as you see omega t, theta prime. Now what is theta prime? It is basically the relative, if I have chosen, suppose say omega prime I have taken. Now it is omega minus omega prime, but they are equal. Omega minus omega prime multiplied by t plus, because initially the particle and the x prime axis, they are having some phase, some difference in angle. So at t is equal to 0, theta prime I have written here is equal to beta. That means there is a angle difference between x prime and the particle, angular difference. So obviously theta prime is equal to omega minus omega prime t plus beta. Since they are equal, omega is equal to omega prime, that is what we have taken, so that is beta. Theta dot is omega here, theta prime dot is omega minus omega prime, which is again 0 because omega is equal to omega prime. Now if you calculate theta double dot, since omega is constant, it is 0 here also it is 0, because you know omega prime also we have taken as constant, omega prime also we have taken constant, so it is coming out to be 0. But suppose it is not, then obviously we will get d omega by dt, that is your alpha will come, or theta double dot will come here. Here also you can write, you know, theta double dot or alpha. Omega prime in general, omega prime basically the angular velocity of the rotating frame. Now omega prime in general for the most of the problems we take as constant, but it may not be constant. In that case you will get, you know, minus alpha prime also. We will see one example where omega prime is not constant. Okay, so from these we can calculate the velocity also. Velocity is r dot r cap plus r theta dot theta cap, and here obviously theta dot is 0, so velocity is r dot r. So we see the difference in velocity that we have already seen there. So the gist of the problem is, or the gist of this is, in r and its derivatives we do not see any difference in this particular case, since this is not, this frame is not moving in the radial direction, and the theta, in the theta part and its derivatives we see the difference because of its rotation, because the r the x prime and y prime axis is rotating. Good. So that is about your r and theta. Now let us come to the most important part, and this is the acceleration part. This is where the real confusion begins. Now in the acceleration part we cannot write so simply, we have to derive. Okay, this derivation we have already done in plane polar coordinates. The acceleration term, this we have done the long derivation, and we are very much thorough with it now, because every time we are writing this equation. The in the rotating frame
in the rotating frame, acceleration is given by this expression. Now, unless we go and do the proof ourselves, it is difficult to understand everything. So it is a rigorous proof is there. But here, for the time being, we can understand it. AI is the acceleration in inertial system or inertial frame. AR is AI minus 2 omega cross VR. Alright? 2 omega cross VR. Now here, omega is the angular velocity of the frame. You know, whatever omega we have chosen, that is the omega. Omega is the capital omega is the angular velocity of the frame. Omega. That is what it is, a rotating frame. And VR is the velocity of the particle with respect to the frame. So that is what this term is. Again, another term. So this is our acceleration term. Later on, we will see, or I will explain further. This is basically, this term is your centrifugal term. This term is your Coriolis term. We will see it here. Okay. Now, the main confusion here is, or the main question that people get is, that this term and this term, that is the terms related to theta bar, theta dot, this term and this term, they are having similarity over here, where omega square r, so this is basically r theta dot square, so this term and this term is having similarity. Exactly the same way, this term and this term, that is 2 omega vr, this is 2 r dot theta dot, they are basically exactly the same, because omega is your theta dot and vr is your r dot. So these two terms are exactly the same. Only thing difference is the direction reverses. The direction reverses. This is basically centripetal acceleration directed towards the center. This is basically your centrifugal acceleration directed outwards. This is your Coriolis curve. Here also there is a Coriolis curve. The direction is opposite. Now, the question comes is, or the confusion of the question, that this is acceleration in some, you know, non-inertial frame. Acceleration in a non-inertial frame, that is totally a separate acceleration. And this is the acceleration in a inertial system, inertial frame. Why there is some kind of similarity in the terms? Is there any relevance? Is there any connection? Why we are getting this kind of similarity? Now this is the main question, or here, you know, there is a confusion. What is the answer to this question? So that is one question there, and this is the one major question it comes to the mind when we compare plane polar coordinate with the rotating frame. Now it is very difficult to answer this question. Now the way I have thought is to explain it to you, because, you know, we are not going into the derivations, and since we are not going into the derivations now, Coriolis term and all these terms I cannot explain to you fully. But whatever, you know, we can understand from this, you know, I will try to explain it to you. Now as you see that the way we can understand is, it is just an understanding part. I multiply this equation with m. Now this is the equation we see, because it is easier to understand in terms of force rather than acceleration. So this is the expression for force. Now here, this is the force in the rotational frame, Fr. F is force in the inertial frame. That means the real forces. So all the real forces will be there in the rotational frame also. Minus 2m omega cross Vr, this particular term, this is known as Coriolis term. So basically it is this term, you know, this is the term Coriolis. this term is a Coriolis term, alright, Coriolis term. And minus m omega cross r is centrifugal force. So this is your centrifugal force. This is your centrifugal force. And if you calculate, you know, using your vectors, the cross product, if you calculate the direction, you will find that this is outward. This direction, that is minus m omega cross r, is always outward. And this term is basically the negative of the, if it is in the theta cap, this is minus theta cap. So this is the force that one experiences in a rotational plane. In a rotational plane, this is the force one will see. That is the real forces minus this Coriolis force and the centrifugal force. Now, I had thought of myself some kind of pictures and explanation, because you know we cannot go to the rigorous proof now, and even if we go, it is a little bit difficult that why there is a similarity between them. So what I have done, I have taken again the same example of the wheel, and there is a bead going outward, whatever example we have been discussing, and using, this is a very simple example, a simple case, and using this simple case, we are trying to understand pictorially. So this is not any mathematically, just pictorially, physically, we are trying to understand that why this kind of similarity is there, or are they totally irrelevant? There is no similarity. They are just mathematically they are coming. So that is the question in our mind. Or is there any similarity between them? So let us try to understand by having a simple example in front of us. It is just a simple example and trying to understand. So, let us see the plane polar coordinate. Now, plane polar coordinate, this is your plane polar coordinate, and this is your r cap, this is your theta cap, and this is your origin O. The theta is measured from the x-axis. Now, here as you see, this r cap, theta cap, or r theta coordinate system is a inertial system. In an inertial frame, when you see a particle, in an inertial frame, when you see a particle, you see that the particle is rotating also. It is going outward, it is rotating. Now, any particle which is rotating, because it is rotating in a circle, obviously, but along with that, it is going outward. So, when it is rotating in a circle, obviously, there is a force towards the center. So, I have drawn that. That is your m into a. This is mv square by r or m omega square r, whatever you say. Now, this force, I have written the expression of the force. Alright? Expression of the force. This is not a force. M into a is an expression of the force. The force is basically either friction or tension or whatever. These are forces. But this is the expression of the force. That is, we call as centripetal force, the net force towards the center. The expression I have written, that is magnitude m into a. So that is what I have shown. So this is not a that way free body diagram. M into a. Okay, so net force towards the center. Same direction I have followed. So it is the same direction I have followed. Now, on the other side, again exactly the same way, the Coriolis term is there. The Coriolis term, this is the Coriolis term. So, with that also, this is the acceleration. So, m into a, you know, I am doing it. So, m into a. So, just I am writing the expression of the force in that direction. So, these are the two real forces which will work on mass m. R double dot, there is no r double dot. So, no force connecting to r double dot. R theta double dot, it is not having any. It is not having any angular acceleration, so obviously that term is also not there, because we are taking a very simple case. Okay, so now as you see, these are the two forces, real forces, which are acting on the system or on the body. Now this is what we see in the plane polar. Now if I take a rotating frame, let us take this rotating frame. A rotating frame is a non-inertial frame. In a non-inertial frame, the Newton's laws are not valid. Okay. So what we try to do, that what should I do so that I can the Newton's laws are valid? What should I do so that Newton's laws are valid? So what is that you do? You add some pseudo forces. So suppose there is a person, an observer in a non-inertial frame. If he has to see something happening within the frame or even outside, what he will do? He will put a force negative, in a direction negative, in which the frame is accelerating. Alright. So, in which the frame is accelerating, in the opposite direction, he will invoke a force. He will add a force in the opposite direction. Mass of that particle multiplied by the acceleration of the frame. That is what we do. And then, you know, we can apply Newton's laws. Exactly the same way I am trying to explain to you. In the rotating system, rotating frame, that means x prime, y prime frame, again I am looking at the particle. So these two forces, real forces, anyway will be there. Because the real forces, whether it is a inertial frame or a non-inertial frame, it will be always there. So these two forces are there. That's why, you know, they are in yellow color. Real forces. Now, this particular person, who is in the rotating frame, he will observe that this particle is moving with uniform speed, and for him this is a uniform velocity, because he will see that this particle is moving in a straight line. And if it is moving in a straight line with uniform speed, that means it is not changing its direction, so obviously the force acting on that particle is zero. So according to Newton's first law of motion, first law is not valid, or second law is also not valid because of, you know, non-inertial frame. But if I want to make it work, so according to that person, if no acceleration is there, that means the net force has to be zero. How can I make net force zero? I have to add pseudo forces. So basically what I have done, this is your m omega square r, centripetal force, alright? Opposite to the centripetal force, I have added exactly m capital omega square r, whereas theta dot is equal to capital omega, that is what we have chosen. So these two forces cancel each other. So force along the r cap direction now is zero. Exactly the same way, this is your Coriolis term, or Coriolis force you can say. This is also Coriolis force we say. This is basically the most of the time we say this force as a Coriolis. This will come in the real force actually, but again the Coriolis acceleration. So I am adding another force, 2m r dot omega, capital omega, in a direction opposite to theta cap, that is your minus theta cap direction. So now in this theta cap also the net force is zero. So now my Newton's laws hold good. Force is zero, acceleration is zero. That is how, you know, a person can apply Newton's law in a rotating, in an accelerating frame. So these two forces are, you know, pseudo forces. Okay. Now, if I write that the force in a rotating frame, force in a rotating frame is the real force, since I am using the vector, real force plus force of pseudo forces. Algebraic sum or vector sum of all of them. Vector sum of all these forces. So the forces in a rotating system, I have divided into two parts. One is real forces. So these are the real forces. I have, you know, circulated this real forces, this one and this one. So this is the real force, alright, plus this pseudo forces. Now I keep this real force means that is in the inertial frame. I keep it like F like this as it is. The real forces which are basically experienced in inertial frame minus this pseudo forces, I can write it like this, like, you know, 2m r dot omega minus theta cap, basically in the theta cap direction, plus m r omega square minus r cap. But instead of that, I write it in this form, minus 2m omega cross vr, minus m omega cross r. It will give the same kind of results, so that we can see the equivalence actually. The equivalence means this one and this one are becoming same. So this basically, you know, it is easy to find out the direction along with this minus sign. So this is your Coriolis force, and this is your, along with the minus sign, this is your centrifugal force. Alright? So as you can see, you are getting exactly the same expression. Is this clear? Now, our confusion and the answer or the question that is we asked, that is solved. The question was, these two terms are having relevance. This term was having relevance with this one. And this term was having relevance with this term. Why are they relevant? Why are they same? Why the signs are, you know, reversed in the opposite direction? If we understand this figure and this figure, we can see that yes, there is a relevance, and it is opposite because we are adding the pseudo forces, and that is how, you know, these terms are having minus minus, the direction is opposite. So I hope that the confusion or the question that we have is clear. But furthermore, it is necessary that we go into that chapter and read and do the full derivation. When we do the full derivation, we can understand everything, and there you can understand the Coriolis force also. So this is a very important topic and important confusion. Now let us come to the next problem. Here in this problem, what I am trying to show is, I have taken one problem and I have solved using plane polar as well as using rotating plane, so that, you know, your confusion gets clear. So let us see well known problem to you. I hope you have done many times. Here there is a sphere, and on the top of the sphere there is a particle. The particle slides, alright? The particle slides, and it will leave the sphere at certain moment. So at this position, when this particle is making an angle theta, this leaves the sphere. So this is the problem. Now, one can solve it using plane polar, one can solve it using rotating plane. So in the plane polar, you have been doing, most of you, using the plane polar coordinate. In the plane polar coordinate, so what is the way to do it? First of all, let us see what are the real forces acting on this particle. So the real forces are the force of gravity, mg, and the normal reaction, n. Okay? Now, these are the two real forces. First of all, we write the energy equation that we know very well. The potential energy lost, the potential energy lost is equal to kinetic energy gained. First equation. Second equation is force equation. Mg cos theta minus n is the net centripetal force. Alright? Mg cos theta minus n, that is m into a, m into omega square r. So that is my second equation. At this point, when the body just leaves the sphere, the normal reaction is 0. Now if you substitute that, you get two equations and two unknowns. The unknowns are your omega and your theta. So you can solve your theta. Now you can get one more equation, that is along the theta cap direction. The force which is acting in the theta cap direction, the component of mg, so it is cos theta on this side, sin theta. So mg sin theta, that gives rise to the angular acceleration, and that is your mr alpha. If one knows theta, one can calculate the alpha, angular acceleration. Now this is about the solving this problem using the plane polar coordinate. Okay. Now let us solve the same equation, same problem using a rotating frame. Okay. Now here what I do, that with the particle I fix a frame x prime y prime. This frame is rotating with the particle. Now as the particle is falling, this frame is also falling, but the particle is accelerating, its speed is not constant. So now this case is different than that case. In that case, the frame we have chosen, actually the rotating frame, it was moving with constant angular velocity. Here it is not, it is accelerating frame. So let us see what are the forces it will act. So our first two forces, that means these are our real forces which is there in the inertial frame of reference. So these two forces are anyway there, that is mg and n. Now the pseudo forces, since as you see it is rotating, so pseudo force has to be there. So we have seen, you know, two pseudo forces we have seen there. So one is the force, centrifugal force outward m omega squared r. Okay, the any other force, what about this Coriolis term? What about this Coriolis, that is your 2m r dot theta dot, will that force be there? It won't be there, because the particle is at rest with respect to the frame. There is no relative velocity of the particle with respect to the frame, that is 0. So there is no Coriolis force. Any other force? Yes, there will be one more force. Since it is accelerating, so if you see this acceleration term, there is r theta double dot also. We have seen there that if omega prime is not constant, then obviously there is a, in the theta dot there is difference. So corresponding to this, that means r theta double dot, corresponding to this term, again there is, just like as I explained to you, there is a corresponding pseudo force that we call as Euler force. But anyway, name doesn't matter. So it is the force which is, we have to, the, it is accelerating in this direction, so the force will be in the opposite direction. So this is the force, and this will be, magnitude is m r alpha, r alpha. So that force is there. Alright, so this is also a pseudo force. Coriolis force is not there, centrifugal force is there. Now let us write the force equation. So in the force equation, what happens, even now as the frame is moving, so a observer in the frame, he observes that the particle is at rest. So all the forces, whether it is your r cap or your theta cap, the algebraic sum, the vector sum or algebraic sum of all the forces should be 0. So mg cos theta along your r cap, mg, or maybe I can say r prime, basically it is in the this x prime coordinate. So mg cos theta minus n minus m omega square r, that is the net force acting along this direction, that should be equal to 0. Along your theta cap or theta cap prime, whatever you say, mg cos theta, sorry, now this is 0. Now if you write m omega square r on other side, mg cos theta minus n is equal to m omega square r. Alright, now as you see that this particular equation is exactly the same as force equation here, and the first energy equation anyway has to be the same as before, so you can solve the problem. So you can solve the problem both way. You can solve it using your plane polar coordinate, that is your inertial frame. You can solve it using a rotating frame which is rotating with the particle, and you have two pseudo forces. You will get exactly the same answer as before and the same equation as before. Now if you want to write the last equation, so it will be what is the force acting in this direction, that is your mg sine theta. So one can write mg sine theta minus pseudo force mr alpha is equal to 0. Again, the net force sigma fx should be equal to, or sigma fr should be equal to 0, r and sigma r theta should be equal to 0. So sigma f in the r theta and r cap. So mg sin theta minus mr alpha is equal to 0, and from there you get back the same equation. So this is how we see that this particular problem can be solved using plane polar and rotating frame, and you get the same answers in both. Now about this lecture, what I mean to say that this is little bit of advanced topic for you, because you know we have to go to the inertial frame, non-inertial frame, to study this in detail. So you may not be so much comfortable with all this, and secondly, if you feel that these things are confusing, you can forget about it for the time being. The most important thing that you need to remember is that the plane polar system, coordinate system, is a inertial frame of system, and the rotating frame is a non-inertial system. This is the most important point that you need to remember. Generally, you will not see this treatment, or you know, this particular answers, or this particular topic, that is a comparison between the two coordinate, that is your plane polar and the rotating system. Basically, some time back, few years back, this question was there in the mind, but I never thought it any deeply. But some days back, I am glad to share with you that I was meditating early morning, and suddenly this whole problem came to my mind, and its answer also, a lot of what I discussed, it came on that day, and immediately I wrote it back, and then I extended it. So I got it, and I felt that I can share this with you. So please, if you are confused about something, please let me know, and let me know your views about this particular topic. Thank you very much.